Hey team, Andre from High Performance Academy here. Welcome to another one of our webinars. And today we're going to be going over the different ways we can control an electric water pump. And these are becoming an increasingly popular upgrade in favor of the mechanical pump that just about every factory engine used to come with. And as we'll find out as we go through today's lesson, there are a number of advantages to the electric water pump, but we also need to give some consideration to the strategy that we're going to use in order to control them if we want to get the most out of those pumps. Before we get into our webinar today though, just a couple of things that have been going on over the last couple of weeks since our last webinar. I'll start of course with our current giveaway, which is still running. We've got 13 days left to run on this. And if we switch across to my laptop screen for a moment, we have partnered with MoTeC on this. We are giving away their epic sized C1212 dash logger unit. This is a massive dash display and it has a huge amount of flexibility just given the sheer amount of screen real estate you've got available to you. Not only can you incorporate a rear view camera, which is exactly what we can see on the demo screen there, you've also got the ability to use MoTeC's pre-programmed displays, which gives you a huge amount of flexibility on how you want to set that up. It can also work with their display creator, which is an added option which you would need to purchase, and then you can create your own bespoke displays. I'm going to actually talk a little bit about that in a few moments as well. Now, the C1212 dash is not only compatible with MoTeC software, MoTeC hardware, I should say, because it is CAN enabled and there is a very flexible CAN template within the MoTeC range of dashes. This essentially lets you use the C1212 dash with just about any ECU that you're probably already familiar with. Can even gather data from a factory OBD2 port as well. So again, huge amount of flexibility and a great addition to just about any project car. On top of that, we are also adding in our suite of courses with our VIP package. That, if you are unaware, gives you access to every single course we already offer. Every course that we ever produce in the future, you will never pay for another course, and lifetime gold membership, which gives you access to our webinars and our online private members only forum. Total value of that entire package is somewhere around about $6,000 US. So it is an epic prize package. Doesn't matter whereabouts in the world you are watching from right now, we will ship this to your door free of charge, so don't think you're going to miss out, maybe because you're not in mainstream US or here with us in New Zealand. There are 13 days left for that giveaway to run. You can head to the link that the team will drop into the chat right now to get your name into the draw. There are a few little tasks you can also do on your way there, which will give you a few extra entries and give you a little bit more chance to win. So I highly recommend you get involved with that giveaway. 13 days left. $6,000 US. It is an epic package. Now, I just wanted to talk a little bit about a pet peeve of mine when it comes to engine building. And this comes up because I am currently putting an FA20 back together with a new set of head gaskets. And this is something that I've seen time and time again with engines that have been rebuilt and then brought into my old workshop for dyno tuning. And unfortunately, while the person who's paying the bills for an engine build doesn't usually get to see the shiny new forged pistons or the expensive H-beam conrods, maybe the upgraded ARP fasteners or any of the other nice expensive parts that go on the inside, this makes it really hard for an engine builder to sort of give an indication maybe of the quality of the build that they have provided. However, what the customer is definitely going to see is the external appearance of the engine. Now, part of this just comes down to common sense. I mean, obviously we want to take our time and do a thorough job of cleaning all of the engine components. If we're dealing with a cast iron block, it's also pretty normal for us to go ahead and paint the cast iron surface of the block, the external surface, because obviously if we don't do that, we're going to end up in a fairly short amount of time with a lot of corrosion. Not essential for alloy, which brings about its own set of issues with aluminium cylinder heads and blocks. These do tend to discolor quite easily and it can be difficult to really get them back to a really factory look. There are a couple of options which I will just mention. A mag wheel cleaner actually does a pretty good job of bringing an alloy casting back to pretty much like new. The other option as well on some less critical parts is you can look at aquablasting with glass bead media. That does a really great job of removing any surface debris, surface marking, and brings it back to a like new appearance. Unlike conventional sandblasting, the glass media that's used with the water blasting tends to not open up the pores in the alloy so much. And I have had components just sandblasted in the past. They look okay when you get them back, but they tend to mark up very quickly. That glass bead combined with high pressure water doesn't tend to do that. So that gives a really good finish. Only thing I will mention with that is you don't want to do that necessarily, or at least you want to be very careful if you are using that on components with complex internal galleries, such as cylinder heads, for example. It's going to require a very thorough and committed approach to cleaning out those components post-blasting. Otherwise, you're almost certainly going to end up in a situation where debris will get trapped inside a gallery or inside the casting and work its way loose when you don't want it to, when the engine is up and running. So that's one aspect, just cleaning the parts. I mean, goes without saying. What I really wanted to talk about was a pretty simple topic, which is the sealant that we use on our engines. What I ended up seeing was a lot of engines come through the door where you looked at the sump or the rocker cover or maybe a front cover that had been sealed to the block with sealant, and big daubs of orange silicon hanging out, which just kind of looks really ugly in my personal opinion. I know I'm being fussy here. Obviously, it's everyone's individual choice. What I always try and do is replicate the factory sealant or factory look of the sealant, which will almost inevitably be a gray sealant. And it does require a specific sealant to do this. The one that a lot of OEs use is threebond. There are a variety of different threebonds within their range, though. This one is 1215. You'll actually find that the factory workshop manual will specify what type of sealant should be used. So that's the first thing. This gets you away from that cheap, nasty auto parts store orange silicon. Now, yes, the orange silicon, you could argue it's going to do the job, right? And yeah, it probably will. However, you do get what you pay for. One of the advantages with the likes of threebond is it does do a far better job of sealing, particularly if you do have irregularities in the surface. So if you don't like oil leaks, you're probably going to get an engine that will be much more resilient or resistant to oil leaks if you use a proper quality sealant like threebond. Yes, it's going to cost you a bit more, actually quite a bit more for threebond, but when you're using such a small amount, I mean, a tube like this, that's going to be sufficient for several engines. So in the big scheme of things, if you're looking at a set of pistons at $500 or $600, honestly, a single tube of threebond is probably the least that you could afford to put into your engine. And what that's going to end up doing, though, as well, is it's going to mean that your engine, when it's assembled, that gray silicon that's going to, or sealant that's going to sort of end up being squeezed out there, is going to replicate that factory look. And for me, it just shows a little bit more professionalism, a little bit more pride has been taken in the assembly of the engine. And again, for the customer, it's one of those few things other than the cleanliness of the external parts that they actually get to see. It's much nicer, again, in my personal opinion, than big globs of orange silicon squirted out between those components. There is another aspect, though, that comes into this as well, which is how we apply the silicon and where it should be, just as importantly, where it shouldn't be applied. And as I say, I've just gone through the process of reassembling some cylinder heads onto an FA20 here, and I just wanted to go through a few photos. So if we'll just head across to my laptop screen here for a second, and I will just get my pointer up and running so that we can actually point out what I wanted to show you. Bear with me here. Right, that's better. All right, so the FA20 engine is an engine that relies very heavily on sealant to seal the different components. This is the camshaft sort of sandwich plate, I like to call it. It bolts on top of the bare cylinder head. So this alloy casting that you can see here, this is sealed to the top of the cylinder head with silicon, and then on top of that, the cam caps, which sit here. We've got the two in the center. We've got one at the back, and we've got another one here that's missing. Those are also sealed with silicon. So one of those aspects when we are assembling an engine is where we should be using the silicon, as I mentioned, and where we shouldn't be. And we don't have to guess. I do mention this pretty heavily in our engine building courses, and it comes down to every aspect when we're building an engine. The torque specs, this is something I always get asked about. What torque specs should we use? You don't need to guess here, and it's really important before you start disassembling or building an engine that you actually find a copy of the factory workshop manual. And these days, unless you are building an engine that is literally fresh off the showroom floor and has never seen the light of day before, you're almost certainly going to be able to find a factory workshop manual floating around somewhere on the internet with a few seconds of Googling. Again, if we jump back to my laptop screen, this is the information from the Toyota factory manual for how to apply the sealant. And we've got the components here. There's a couple of them. These are the rear caps here. And this is the front cap, which is a little bit more involved. That actually goes across both of the camshafts together. So what it does, and it is a little bit hard to see on my laptop screen here, but basically it shows a nice little line here of how to apply that sealant to the component before it's installed. And it goes a little bit further than that as well. It actually gives you cross sections here. So it says AA, so we can reference AA and see what that actually looks like. And then if you want to go a little bit further, which we definitely should, you can then refer down below and it will actually tell you what the diameter of the bead of silicon should be. So we can see all of that information down here. So there again is absolutely no need to guess. Now, why that's important is if we look at the rear cap here, which is what we've just looked at, where we should be applying that silicon, we'll get that under our overhead here. So this includes the journal that the camshaft actually runs in. It is very easy, particularly if you take the mentality that more is better when it comes to sealant, it's very easy to end up with too much of that sealant through this particular area here. Then when we bolt the cap down, that sealant has to squish. I'll get my words out, squish out. So some of it, of course, is going to come out this way, no harm done there. If we end up with too much silicon going towards the inside, it can end up here on the inside of that cam journal, and that can easily result in some pretty catastrophic failure of the camshaft. Now you can see here, probably a little difficult, but there is actually a little channel here, a little hollow between where we're going to apply that sealant line and the camshaft journal. And that is designed purely to allow that silicon with sealant to squidge out there and be absorbed essentially into that little channel, that little hollow, without making it into the cam journal. But again, of course, if we apply too much, something's got to give and is going to go into that hollow. So again, if we jump back to my laptop screen, that is why if we actually look at this, there are two different cross sections given, and basically the recommendation for the sealant where it runs closest to that cam journal, the bead should be a little bit smaller. So these are the small details that don't take a lot of effort to find. What they're going to result in is, first of all, the confidence that you haven't missed anything. You've put that bead of sealant exactly where it needs to go, is going to do the job, and it is going to result in an engine that does not leak oil. That is, again, one of my pet hates. I do not like drips of oil on my workshop floor or my driveway, and I definitely don't want to see oil drips on the floor with a freshly built engine. That's a good sign that something has been missed or you haven't done your job right. And the other aspect, of course, there is that if you follow the workshop manual like this, you're going to ensure that we don't have any silicon getting into places it shouldn't, with all of the inherent risk of mechanical failure that could come from that. So just a little tip there. Yeah, it's something that probably should go without saying, but time and time again, I see engines that are built with too much sealant, not enough sealant, the horrible orange sealant that I've already talked about, and these are things that are very cheap and easy to avoid. So factory workshop manual, not only that, it's going to give you all of the information that you need for disassembly and reassembly. Yes, on some engines, they are relatively straightforward and stripping and reassembling can be done without the requirement of a workshop manual aside from the necessary torque specs. But when we get into engines that are a little bit more complex, like the Subaru FA20 here, this really does require the workshop manual for some of the more intricate aspects, like doing the cam timing. That has a very specific process, and if you don't follow that process, you're very likely to end up with bent valves. It is not something that you would be able to stumble upon or guess without that workshop manual. Before we move on, I'll just have a jump across to my laptop screen again, and this is the head side of the mating to that cap that we've just looked at, and you can see again exactly like what I've just talked about. There is that same little hollow in there that the sealant goes into. This one is for some reason being assembled with a black sealant. Again, probably not necessarily my favorite, maybe not quite as obtrusive as orange, but again, use the recommended sealant. And if you're thinking that I'm sounding a little bit over the top with my dislike of orange sealant, I can't exactly explain why I formed such a hatred of it. It might have come from working on older cars back in my early days, where the customers who owned the cars really maybe didn't have the required funds for maintenance or just normal upkeep. And I saw a lot of Mitsubishi VR4 Galants with 4G63 6-bolt engine coming in with, instead of replacing the rocker cover gasket, which was always prone to leaking on those vehicles, the rocker cover would be taken off and the whole gasket would actually be smeared with this horrible orange silicone and then slapped back down. Maybe it got the job done, but it just looked absolutely atrocious, and it just made it heaps harder for anyone else to work on that car when the rocker cover needed to come off. Now, I mentioned with our C1212 giveaway, you've got the option of working with MoTeC's Display Creator. I just wanted to quickly highlight, it's an ongoing project, but this is something Sam, who does our animations, graphics, and video editing and shooting for HPA, got involved with. And this is a custom display for our Toyota SR86 race car. As I've said, it is a bit of a work in progress. We haven't actually got the opportunity to test this out on the track and see what's required, but basically what I wanted to do is have the ability to refine what was displayed on the screen, giving me the information that was most relevant to me in a way that I couldn't get with MoTeC's off-the-shelf displays. This is very sort of based off a modern GT3 dash display, and if anyone's used iRacing, this will be pretty familiar on some of the GT3 cars. There's always a bit of flexibility on how they look, but basically giving the key information that we want. So what we find is that with these aftermarket dash displays in a race car, we only really look at the dash when we need a piece of information. We're not watching the rev counter. It's almost completely irrelevant. We're only watching shift lights normally. So that's why we can see the RPM bar up here. It is there, so we can see if we wanted to what the RPM is, but it forms a very minor aspect of the overall display. I've got gear position down here. Obviously, that's something that is important, particularly when we're coming up to a standing start or a rolling start. We want to make sure that we have got first gear engaged. Likewise, coming into pit lane, we want to know that we've got first gear selected. We've got some of the engine vitals over here on the left-hand side, and again, I don't necessarily want to be able to look at these. So these are color coded, and what happens is when they're outside of their normal working range, they'll be red like they are right now. When they're within the range that we're happy with, the coloring goes away, so they'll just fade into obscurity. Likewise, tire pressure monitoring will be down here, and that'll be exactly the same. So when the tires are below their normal operating pressure, they'll be perhaps blue. When they come into their working range, the colors will disappear, so that just becomes not an invasive piece of information. And maybe if they get too hot and the pressure comes up, we can display them in another color. We've got information here that is basically useful mainly for the likes of qualifying and practice. So three pieces of information here. We've got our last lap time, our best lap time, and then a lap time difference or differential. Particularly in quali, that's quite important to watch. You know that if that lap time differential is zero or showing a gain, 15, that you're up over your best time. So obviously that's great. What that allows you to do is decide maybe if the lap isn't quite going right, you can throw the lap away, basically back off, reset, and get ready to go again. In an actual race, I very seldom look at the actual lap times, except for maybe once I've gone across the start finish line. And then at the top right here, we've got traction control and boost set points. Bottom line, we can also bring up some different information to show different parameters as and when we need it. Now, another aspect with this is I wanted to change the overlay or the way the dash worked when we had the pit limiter active, because when I'm on the pit limiter, what I'm most interested in is making sure that I am at the 40k speed limit. So I've got a separate screen here, and what this shows us is our pit mode is active. We've got our gear and our RPM still at the top, and this number here in the middle, which highlighting red on red, unfortunately doesn't work. Who knew? The number in the middle, of course, is our actual speed. And again, this will be color coded. So essentially, if we go above 40 kilometers an hour, the whole screen will go red, just like it is now. When we're maybe between 38 and 40K, which will be the sweet spot, it'll be green. And maybe if we are below 38 kilometers an hour, it'll turn another color to show that we're going a little bit too slow. So this is the sort of flexibility you can get with Display Creator. Basically, the sky's the limit. It's really just up to your imagination. So pretty keen to get back to the racetrack and actually test that out and see what we like, what we don't like, and what changes are required. All right, let me just get back across to my notes here for a moment. Now we have just released our latest podcast, so we'll jump across to my laptop screen. For those who aren't already following Speed Academy, make sure you do so. They are great guys based out of Canada. We've known Pete and Dave for a number of years. We used to get the opportunity to bump into them at SEMA and PRI when we were over in the US. Unfortunately, we haven't done that for a while, but looking forward to getting back there hopefully this year. Speed Academy have a very popular YouTube channel. They cover a wide range of different topics, including engine building, but what they're maybe best known for, maybe what they like the most, is engine swaps. They've done a number of them over the years, and you can follow some of those on their YouTube channel. But particularly in our podcast, we got into the nitty-gritty of what goes into a engine swap, what you need to know, and the common pitfalls and mistakes to avoid, particularly with modern vehicles with more complicated electronics. Engine swaps are becoming increasingly difficult. So we talk about what's required, as well as their two JDM Legends cars, two of my favorite cars, the JZA 80 Supra and the R34 Nissan GTR that they have been working on. If you are interested in checking out that podcast, you can go to hpa-tunedin.com. And you also be able to find us by searching on basically anywhere you currently listen to podcasts. We're really enjoying producing the podcast. We're enjoying getting some great quality guests onto the pod. And if you are interested in cars, which I'm guessing you are if you're watching right now, I know that this is going to be another great way for you to absorb some excellent content from some really smart people from around the world. If you do like what you hear, we would love it if you could give us a rating and leave us a review. We take all our reviews on board and try and make the podcast as good as we can. So check that out, hpa-tunedin.com. All right, we'll finish up there by just reminding you our MoTeC giveaway, that C1212 dash, as well as our VIP package, $6,000 worth of value up for grabs, 13 days left to get your name into the draw. And again, there will be a link in the comments that you can follow to get your name in there and give you a chance of grabbing that great package. Do not miss out, zero cost to get involved, zero risk, and again, we'll ship it free of charge to your door if you are the lucky winner. All right, thanks for watching there. Give me a moment and we'll get started with today's lesson. If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.